action attorneys over the years. And not being an attorney, I don't claim to be one, but I give you guys some little sneak peeks and ideas of how we have our stuff structured and how I recommend people structure stuff. And so the second week is all about that. And then we third week is where we first and second week are like prerequisites in college, right? It's like your first year of college. You're doing all your prerequisites. And then your third week is actual investment content. And we break down a lot of different commercial deals, residential deals, and all the investment strategies and how we actually structure stuff and do things. And then it's 10 weeks of that, you know, so you guys will enjoy that stuff.
Okay. Sounds good.
Well, great. Harold, great meeting you. John, great meeting you guys. I'm going to go live here on Facebook and we're going to get our weekly YouTube deal done right now. But I look forward to talking to you guys a little bit more, and it's great to have a little one-on-one call with you guys before our strategy call next week. Welcome to the team, all gentlemen. Right.
Sounds great. Thanks, Ron. Excellent. Thank you. Looking forward to it.
Yeah. Thank you, guys. Have a good one. Bye-bye. Okay. We live.
We're on. Live, man. We're trying all six cell phones going. It's what we got to do, right?
All right. Take it. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Real Talk on Real Estate. And I'm going to get set up here. Daniel, we're a mess today in regards to our logistics. And this is the way I roll, ladies and gentlemen. This is real life business, real life stuff. We're not sitting here talking about wanting to do things. We're actually doing things. There's a yellow notepad in there with my notes on it. You can grab that yellow notepad for me. That's all my YouTube live stuff. I don't even need the pen. You can just leave that down there. So, ladies and gentlemen, Real Talk on Real Estate. We're doing it here from a job site. You got concrete trucks in the background. You look at that backdrop over here. There's the development is going this opposite way in here. Lots of vacant dirt and land. And then we got some vacant land and dirt right behind us on the other side here. And so there's about 200 pad sites that are going in on this development. Now, people want to know how to buy land and how to build houses. And I'm going to do it simply. I'm not going to tell you guys how to go in and buy a bunch of land for real estate development in this magnitude, because this is a whole different level. And there's some people on here that have the capabilities of doing this. I want to talk to you guys about how we got started with our first home. And so I'll tell you guys a story. Back in 2000, I decided to buy one lot. And I sat down with my dad. My dad's an accountant. He's not a builder. He's not a builder. He's not an entrepreneur by any stretch of the imagination. A 32-year accountant. One thing he is he's smart and very diligent, very analytical. And I respect my dad. Great ethics, great morale, and just a stand-up person that you want as a father, right? But not an entrepreneur by any stretch of the imagination. He built one house his entire life. It was the house that he built for us as a family when we were younger, and he built it with his two hands. And so I knew he knew the processes of doing it because he did it, and he did it himself with a little bit of help from friends, family, aunts, uncles, relatives, you know. And that's how he built the house. Some subcontractors, but mostly he did 90% of the work himself. And so I sat down with my dad. I built a spreadsheet on Excel and I told my dad, look, you know, we've been doing construction now for a couple of years. We're pouring concrete. We're doing a lot of different things in the construction industry, metal stud framing and drywall. Dad, I like to build some homes. I think they'd be profitable. I'd already done some spreadsheets of stuff on land and what I thought they would be selling for. I looked at the areas that I wanted to buy in and I knew what the houses were selling for in that area. And so I thought, okay, I just need to know the process, you know, of how I need to structure things if I build. So we sat down one day, we built this spreadsheet and I said, okay, this is what I need to do. So then I went in and I tried to buy land as inexpensive as I could. I went into the nicest areas and bought a piece of land for a reduced price. And what helped me was I was facilitating business with customers in these neighborhoods. So I was talking to them about what they paid for their houses, how much that they had purchased their land for. And so I had probably had a year of this before I even decided to do this on my own, because curiosity had sparked in my mind. And I thought, okay, so they paid X amount at that time. I think it was like $350,000 for their house. This was back in the late 90s, early 2000s. And then they were paying about maybe $50,000 for an acre of land. And so I sat back and said, okay, $50,000 acre of land. Let me see what I can get this for. So I negotiated, found a piece of land real close to where these people were for $35,000. So I bought an acre of land for $35,000. It already had utilities on it. I didn't have to go in and do infrastructure development. I was just able to go in and I was just able to go in and turn key. I was able to pick up the land, go in and buy the land, buy the house, buy the land, and then build the house. And I didn't have to do a lot of zone changes or any of that stuff. But what I did do is this, and I still do this to this day. And so one of the recommendations that I'm going to talk to you guys about today is how we assess values, you know, and how we know it's profitable. Because at the end of that house, I made about an $80,000 profit on the real estate. And so people go, okay, your first deal, you made $80,000. It was a win-win deal for us, you know, $80,000 profit. It was a great win. And I did it very conservatively. It took me a little bit of time to acquire the land, do my research study and stuff. And when I say it took me some time, I'm a quick mover. Once I know I want to do something, I move fast. And so when I say it took me some time, I took the time, whether it was 30 days or 60 days to do my homework. I went and had an architect draw up a house that was a similar square footage. So I asked neighbors, I said, how big is your house? How much did you pay for it? And I get in people's face, like in a nice way. I talked to them about real estate. Oh, man, you have such a beautiful home. What did the construction cost you? What did you guys line up paying for the house? You know, very non-threatening, and just talking to them by commending them and complimenting the beauty of their home. And so by doing that, they were prideful in their new asset, right? They were excited to share their home with me. They said, yeah, come on inside. I even have people, they'd pull me inside and walk me through their houses. And so I got to see the trim outs. I got to see what they were putting in there. And we didn't have cell phones available, like with all the cameras and stuff like we do now. So I had to get this visual mindset of everything that they had going on in there. And so I sat back and I said, okay, I'm going to do this based on what I'm noticing that they have as far as trim out items and finished construction. Now, at those days, I didn't know anything about the quality of materials or anything. So I kept it super simple. I bought all my stuff from Home Depot and Lowe's. And I'll tell you, most of the stuff, the first house I built was probably not the best quality home that I've ever built by any stretch of the imagination. In fact, I know it's not. And I made some mistakes on it, but I still made $80,000. And I learned a lot from that first house. So what I'm urging people to do is your first house that you do is not going to be perfect. You're going to make some mistakes for sure. There's going to be less than desirable quality issues that you probably have with it. But you know, maybe you price it right where you profit, but you give somebody a little bit more of some other stuff, but you're going to make some mistakes. It's inevitable. It's part of the game. It's going to happen no matter what. And so one of the things that we landed up doing was we landed up going in and getting designs made on this lot. So I got this where people were paying $50,000 for land. I went in and found a lot for $35,000, just a couple blocks away, but it was where the development was moving. And so I had a little dirt road section that people had to go onto, but I was able to go in and buy it for a little bit lower acquisition price. Now, I went in, I hired an architect. He did a design on a house, and I was able to go in and do comparable elevations to match what was going on in that subdivision. And so I put the plans together based on the square footages of what people had going on right there. And so obviously I didn't want to build the biggest house in the subdivision. It was my first home, but I also didn't want to build the smallest home in the subdivision either. So I took something, a happy median. And so I found that people were building like, you know, 21 to 2,500 square foot houses. So I built a 2,300 square foot house. First house I built, it was a 4-bedroom home, 2.5 bath. One bathroom in the master bedroom, one bathroom in the hallway between the other bedrooms that were on the side, on the opposite end of the house, and then we did a powder room for a company, and so and it was a 4-bedroom house. I don't build 4-bedroom houses anymore. I build 3-bedroom houses now and more expensive homes, but they fit a different market sector. But at that time and for the longest time, I built 4-bedroom homes. I knew 4-bedroom homes sold better. And from day one, I did 3-car garages. I was a garage guy. I love cars. And I was able to find a little niche in the market on how to build 3-car garages for almost the same cost with the additional cost of materials. But labor-wise, almost the exact same cost as building a 2-car garage, but just give people more for their money, because garages don't cost you much to build because most subcontractors bid the price of the house based on the heated square footage. Like the framers bid it on the heated square footage, and they charge you just a flat fee on the garage. And so I was able to get the garage built for a very modest price, right? And so I learned that early on. And so I got the plans. Before I even turned dirt on this residence, I took this set of plans and I started taking out to sending it out to subcontractors. Now, people are asking, how did I find subcontractors? Well, because we were in the construction industry, I had a few, right? Not all of them. By far, I didn't have all of them. So I was sitting in the same position a lot of you guys are right now going, okay, where do I find these people? Well, you know what I did? I went into track home subdivisions. And what track homes are pre-planned communities, right? They're like Toll Brothers, DR Horton. Those are track home subdivisions. But there's subcontractors out there all the time, all day long. And one of the big things about being in a subdivision is that you have these contractors. I just went up and saw, I got my electrician that I still have today. In fact, his workers were out there wiring up a house. I went in, he had said Johnny's Electric in yellow, big yellow vans. And it had his phone number on there. And I took the phone number off that. And I went in and said, hey, by chance, are any of you guys Johnny? And he wasn't there. And he said, no. I said, hey, I got a house that I want to get a bid on. Do you think you'd be interested in bidding? And they said, yeah, call the number on the van. And so I did. And I met Johnny. He came to my office, picked up a set of plans. And we called the Academy Reprographics, the reprographic place that produced the plans for us. And we put all the subcontractors' names on it so I didn't have to personally meet with them. And we called them and said, hey, if you want to bid this house, we have a new custom build that we're doing in the town and municipality that we're going into. And I sent out as many. I probably spent like $500 on plans just to reprint full-size sets of plans for people. And then I got savvier and just gave people the pages that they needed over the course of time. We poured the concrete because we were the concrete guys. But I still had to get the dirt work done, and didn't know exactly how to get the pre-slab stuff done. So I hired a guy to do the pre-slab stuff for us with a tractor, compact, hired an engineer to take soil tests on it. And then we went in and I got prices on it. And then once I got the prices and the bids from people, I figured out which subcontractors I was going to use. And then I added up all the numbers. And then I went to the title company and I called a title company that was local and said, hey, how much would it be to close on this deal? And we knew the real estate fees were going to be about 6%, 33% for the buyer's broker, 3% for the seller's broker. And so I added all these fees up, right? And then at the end, I said, okay, I asked my dad, he was an accountant. I said, Dad, do I have to pay taxes on this stuff, like sales tax and stuff? And he said, actually, yeah, you do. Minus the land. So I took that expense into it as well. I subtracted out the land. You guys see a lot of activity in there. There's a lot of concrete trucks coming and going behind us. So I took all the costs minus the land, and I had to pay gross receipt taxes on that. And so we were like at a 6% gross receipt tax bracket basis. And so what we landed up doing was we took that 6% tax bracket basis. And I added that into my expenses because that was an expense I was going to have at the end of the sale. And then plus some interim property taxes, some payment and interest stuff that I was going to have to be able to build the house. And I added all up all those costs. And I said, okay, if I could build it for this, this would be my profit subject to the prices that we're currently selling in that market sector. And I said, man, I could make like $85,000 on this house if I do it right, you know? And so I did. So I went in, I did all my homework, and almost to a T, I made almost the exact profitability that I had set out to make because I did my due diligence prior to breaking ground on that project. In fact, I think I was so conservative that I landed up making about an extra $5,000 to $10,000 on that house because I think I was set up to make about $75,000. I made somewhere between $80,000 and $85,000. So I made somewhere between $5,000 and $10,000 more in profit than I would have otherwise. And so nonetheless, everything that I'm talking to you guys about here today is about being conservative more than anything, but doing your due diligence, not so conservative that you land up losing a deal. Because I see a lot of people that what's the saying? Ty sent me this little thing the other day. This is us using a napkin and had all these contraptions and stuff made you wiping your face with a napkin super complicated. You don't want to make this complicated. It's super simple. Biggest thing is you don't want to lose a deal because you're over negotiating it. But I will tell you that in early years, I made some people mad because I negotiated aggressively and hard, and I was super conservative. I just didn't want to lose. I didn't want to lose my money. I didn't want to lose someone else's money. I didn't want to lose the bank's money. I didn't want to lose my credit. I just wanted to make sure that I knew what I was doing. And I know you guys are sitting here right now feeling the exact same way. So what I tell you guys to do is go in and just assess lot prices. Everything's expensive right now, so you got to be careful. I tell people that, you know, when things are this stimulated and they're this high, people continue to see things rise. And I've been mistaken that I thought things were going to drop substantially earlier, but they continue to rise. But at some point in time, there's a bubble, right? And it's going to burst. It's going to come down. And so you have to be conservative enough to know that you don't want to overpay for anything right now. And if you're having problems finding a lot, I wasn't willing to overpay. I don't urge you guys to overpay. Pay fair market value or just below fair market value. Go in. If you have to just be just a street forward from somebody to get the right price you need, the comps within a 1 mile radius are going to be the same anyway. So for banking parameters, you're going to be A-okay as far as comps and resale prices to be able to get the house in acquisition for the price you want to sell it for, as long as you do your homework and make sure you don't look at the houses that are for sale and look at the sales price. You look at the prices that they actually sold for, right? And so you want to get comps from your realtors on houses that sold in the last 6 months and actual prices that they sold for and the price per square foot that they sold for in very similar square footage range. So nothing within 300 square feet of each other. So if you're building a 2,300 square feet house, don't take comps on anything under 2,000 square feet and nothing over 2,600 square feet. And you take those comps in that little sector there and you make sure that you have a sales price that is conducive and that people are selling for currently, not speculating they're going to go up, just currently. And then you go in, you buy your land. I try to be a little under on my land cost just to have a buffer for unforeseen expenses, which you will have. But you want to make sure that you go in and assess impact fees and construction costs, right? So impact fees are the fees you pay to get like utilities, public improvements, curbs and gutters, driveways and stuff put in. And so you go in, you tip most cities, impact fees cost between $5,000 and $10,000. We have one municipality out here where they cost about $13,000 per single family home. But for a single family home, that's about $350,000 to $500,000. If you're building it out, you should be between $5,000 and $10,000, give or take on impact fees. And then you do your construction assessments, as I made mention before. Now, number three, pricing and building the home for profit. Okay. You want to build comparable to what's in there. Now, what people buy is they buy kitchens and they buy bathrooms. They buy exterior facades, right? You want to do something that gives people a little more for their money. So I always urge the three-car garage. If you don't have room for three-car garage, I got a Washington State project that we're doing single-car garages and double-car garages because they're in condensed areas and they're just happy to have garages in these areas, in these inner city areas. But in rural areas, bigger areas, we have bigger lots, three-car garages, kitchens and bathrooms, finished fixtures. People don't buy doors, buy hollow core doors. I noticed on MTV Cribs when I started building, I was like putting these expensive doors in, all solid wood, gorgeous doors, knotty pine doors with all the knots and stuff in them. They were gorgeous. And I was spending an extra $4,000 on doors. And I was looking at MTV Cribs and I was like, man, these people are putting $1 million homes together with what I consider garbage doors, right? Well, shit, I pulled those doors out of my houses because I was using Formica countertops at that time because I was an idiot. I didn't know what to do, right? I didn't have any training. I'm telling you guys. So I used that money to put granite. And so I took that $4,000. I upgraded from Formica to granite, and that helped me sell my houses better because the women hated the Formica countertops. Well, I was stupid. I didn't know that back then. So I took the doors out, and to keep my costs in check, I put nicely painted hollow core two panel or six panel doors. They sold the houses just as easily as pine doors did. And no one even ever missed the pine doors. Not one person ever made mention of them. And so lo and behold, we landed up making a pivot in that regards. So with that being said, we landed up doing more granite, beautiful backsplashes in the kitchen, better appliances in the kitchen, and bigger master bathrooms. People and women love walk-in closets and master bathrooms. And so we put more money into the master bedroom, the master bathroom, the closets, all of that stuff. And so nonetheless, we went ahead and invested more into that stuff. And then we figured out what type of floor plans worked. I do a wraparound floor plan on all my houses, stuff that you can come into the garage, walk up the hallway, go into the master bedroom, into the laundry room, or you can go from the master bedroom the opposite way into the laundry room and then into the pantries. We do these big butler's pantries now where people don't have to prep cook in their kitchen. So we give them more open kitchen space, more open living room space, and higher ceilings. And less countertops in there, but we do these butler's pantries. So there's a lot of cabinet space in there. They can put a lot of their appliances inside the butler's pantry, and people love them. When you come in from the garage, you can go into the butler's pantry with your grocery, or you can come from the kitchen and the living room into the butler's pantry the opposite way. We put receptacles up on the cabinets, and people love them. They sell homes. Big, tall ceilings. Again, the construction costs cost you more in lumber. But the construction costs are modest. Right now, we probably would go with 9-foot ceilings in the main part of the house, as opposed to 10-foot ceilings because of the cost of materials. And then we would probably land up going, instead of 16-foot ceilings on the entryway, go down to 14-foot ceilings and try to save a little bit on materials and stuff right now, because those houses will still sell for as much money. But when I love those old big open floor plans. So we go bigger and taller, and we give people a little bit more in that regards, and they sell our homes. And so that's important. Now, hiring contractors. So I talked to you guys about how I got my contractors. Another way is I vet them through like Angie's List and Home Advisor. Some of the ways that I was talking about, if they're only doing stuff for builders, that a lot of times they're not on Angie's List and Home Advisor. So you can't vet them in that regards. You got to do it just based on face-to-face relationships. Do I trust this person? Do I like this person? What's their track record? How long have they been doing work for this other contractor? Does the other contractor like this person? Do they have a good reputation? Do they not? Talk to people. Just get in their face and just talk to people. Ask them questions and make sure that you're doing your due diligence when you're finding contractors. But I just drove around subdivisions and I really just went up to people and I asked them, who are you using for drywall? Who are you using for insulation? I would see the trucks in there. And then I started calling and getting estimates from those companies because I obviously knew they had experience. If they were doing 100 homes in the subdivision, they could do one of my peddly homes that I felt when I first got started, right? And so that's how I found a lot of my contractors, was just by going in. And I found some through referrals. You know, when I found good contractors that I liked and respected, I'd say, hey, you guys are in these homes. Who's doing the plumbing in these homes? Who's doing the heating and cooling in these homes that you guys are working on? They tell me the company names. Then I just call them. And in the beginning, I had to juggle a few contractors. Some worked out really well. Most of them did. And one or two are always a pain in the ass. And so you're going to have problems with one or two of them. You get through that project with them. You make sure that you get them warrantied. And then you change the contractor on the next home. I still do that, where I keep multiple contractors. And every time these guys start sitting on what I call their fat horse, where they just are starting to escalate prices on me and I'm starting to pay more, I sit back and say, man, the acquisition cost is going way up. I'm going to check my pricing. And then I go out and I put things out to bid again. And I bring more bids in to be able to check their pricings, keep everybody honest. And I do that consistently. I still do that to this day. I did it in the beginning to make sure my profitability was where it was. And I do it today to continue keeping my profitability where it is. I don't get lazy. I don't get sloppy. I just keep doing it the way I've been doing it back then, same way I do it today. So hiring contractors. Number five, project management. Look, ladies and gentlemen, I'm going to talk about this all day long because this is where most people fail in anything that they do. You can be a veteran in real estate investing. You can have 20 years of real estate investing experience and still suck at project management. I can't tell you how many times, time and time and time and time again, I have friends, colleagues, students, people that call me and say, Jerome, I want you to look at this project with me. And I show up to their project. They've been doing multifamily, $10 million, $7 million deals. And I show up and it's a clusterfuck, excuse my language, but it's a clusterfuck on the job sites and there's nothing that's organized. And I sit back and I just think, God, I just think of all the profitability that's flying out the window, flying out the window, flying out the window. And I'm sitting back going, man, if these folks just had a system that they used every single day that they could project manage better, they would save themselves thousands upon thousands of dollars, if not millions of dollars on large projects. And it would just make their life so much easier, so much less stressful. But the problem is they don't. And so they land up costing themselves money all the time. And they cost themselves time. Time, and time is money. And I tell people, if you cost yourself money, that's one thing, right? But if you cost yourself time and money, that's huge. That's a big deal. And so one of the biggest things that we've done is the systems. I've been fortunate in so many ways. Thank God that I had the foresight to go to college, want to get some smarts, a little bit of smarts, because I was not the smartest kid growing up. I was kind of dumb. I couldn't read. I was dyslexic. And so I was never the smartest kid in class, but I was smart enough to push myself to go out and at least get myself up to a normal standard, because I was below standards when I was a kid. And so that helped. But second thing that made me smart is I got into construction, and the construction made me a better investor. And so for those of you guys that don't have the fortunate opportunities of being in construction, I did. And so I was able to put systems together to make my construction company profitable. And I even talked to one of my employees about this yesterday, one of my foremans. I said, look, you guys don't understand. Profitability can evaporate quick if I just exhaust 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 weeks of labor on this job site, I make nothing. You guys have to understand that where these become profitable is where I manage them on a time frame in a systematic way, where we get the guys in, out, done, and move on to something else. Same exact thing on your value add project, same exact thing on your new construction projects, same exact thing on any type of renovation, fix and flip, or anything. You set a time parameter. You go in on that time parameter, and what you do is you systematically put things in order, and you say, okay, this is what we're going to do first. This is how many days we have to do, and you got to be realistic with it. But it takes management. You got to push people, and you tell them, you convey to them from the beginning your work list and your schedule. And I always get people in early, knowing that they're always going to be late. I always tell them, hey, we're ready for you. Come in and let's get this thing going. Let's get the heating and cooling going. We need penetrations done. The roof is decked. We have plywood on the roof. I need penetrations done so I can get the roofers up there, so I get the plumbers, the electricians, everybody in there to get their penetrations done early. And then that way, when the roofers come in, boom, we get the roof done. We're on track. We just keep moving along. Then all the plumbers, this HVAC, all that stuff gets done. We get our inspections. I schedule the insulation guys with the inspectors. Then I call in. We're always pushing the inspectors and the insulation guys, inspectors and insulation guys. And we do it in a systematic way where we just piggyback things. And I convey to them, the inspector, hey, I got insulation guys coming. They're scheduled. It's busy. Can you get down here today? Because we need to get this approval done. And I convey that to the inspectors, and they say, I'm going to try to get out there. I'll get down there. We'll get it done. And we exercise these relationships that we have with professionals, with people out there in the field. And so it's a systematic way that we manage these. And so understanding that when you start these projects, you just don't go into them going, okay, I'm going to get this thing built, or I'm going to get this thing renovated, and you don't have a plan. You have to have a plan of action. So look, for those of you guys who don't, in the link, we're going to go ahead and put the link in here to a webinar. It's a free webinar I put together. You're going to want to click on this link. It's about a 50-minute webinar, and it talks about just this. It talks about the 14 steps to developing real estate and developing land, and the 8-step process that we use for every single project. Same punch list items that we've been doing for over 25 years in my office. We still use it today. It's yours, and it's free, and I talk about it for 50 minutes in this webinar. All you guys got to do is click the link that my team puts up in the comment section and in the bio, and go watch that webinar, because we talk about the systems and project management. I talk about how we work to be able to facilitate that correctly. And so, look, ladies and gentlemen, the biggest thing is go out there and take action, because what most people fail at is they never take action. They never get started. And so I want to urge you guys to get started, take action, and make a move by going out and buying a piece of land. And then that shows that you're serious about what you're doing. And then take a little bit of time. Once you guys have bought land, take a little bit of time to go in and do your due diligence correctly. Right? Figure out what your costs are. Find out before you buy the land what the houses are selling for. Talk to a general contractor, see how much it's costing for them to build the similar type home that you want to build. They might have better connections, better contacts. So you might want to give yourself a 5% variance contingency, just in case you make some mistakes, because you will. And that's okay, because if at the end of the day, you think you're going to make $100,000 profit on a house that takes you 6 months to build, on top of what you're doing right now, because it doesn't take a lot of extra work to build one house. Well, what if you make $80,000 because you make a $20,000 mistake? Is it still worth it? And in my eyes, yeah, you're learning. You got paid to learn. And anytime you're learning and earning capital at the same time is a huge deal, man. I mean, I would do it for free, and I have done it for free. I do a lot of things for free because I'm trying to get to the next level where my investment is going. I do a lot of shit for free. And I don't care. I don't mind doing it, because if I learn, I know when to make that profit back on the second deal or the third deal, the fourth deal, and hundreds of deals from there forward. And so just go in and get started. Be conservative. Buy just a little bit under market rate for the land. And go in and do your assessment. Make sure you understand what construction costs are going to cost you. And if a builder tells you it's costing X amount, get a consensus with two or three builders that construction amount is really close between all three of them. And then make your numbers work. And if your numbers are skewed substantially, you know you're doing something wrong, especially if these guys are doing it every single day. There's a subcontractor in there that's substantially higher than they're supposed to be. But then at the end of the day, project management. Have a system of events set in place that allows you to go in and successfully turnkey this project so that you can go in and turn profits long term. And so, ladies and gentlemen, it's Real Talk on Real Estate. It's Thursday morning, and I thank you guys. You like content just like this, I want you guys to do me a huge favor. If you want to see more content just like this, more value, if we're adding value to you, give us a big fat thumbs up. Give us some love. Just let me know that you appreciate the content that I'm producing, that you're taking away little golden nuggets from whatever I'm doing. And if that way, if I don't get any thumbs up, I know that I suck and I need to do something better. But I know this stuff works for me, so I know it'll work for you if you implement it correctly. But give us a big fat thumbs up and subscribe to our YouTube channel. Give us a little bit of love. You want to get notified anytime we have content just like this or we're doing a live, subscribe to our YouTube channel. Anytime new content comes out, you get notified, and we appreciate you guys. Go out and make it a great day. It's Real Talk on Real Estate. Don't forget, go out and compound your success. Have a good day and God bless. We need to do an opt-in for that.